So there was one of those proverbs, I think last night, maybe it was James at dinner that talked about how it is that if we want to go fast, we walk alone. If we want to go far, we walk together. So as a school, you might think that we want to walk alone because we want to walk fast. We do. But on the other hand, we can't go very far unless we work with others. Two of the partners that have been most important to us in this journey, one has been University of Cape Town, where one of our fabulous graduates, Francois Bonici, runs the Bertha Center. So we have written cases with the Bertha Center on social impact in Africa, and they're a great partner. The other partner more locally is the Oxford Martin School. The Oxford Martin School, for those of you who don't know it, is an entity within Oxford that supports interdisciplinary research on the big global issues of the day. And our next speaker, our keynote speaker, is Professor Carlos Lopez, who has affiliations with both of those organizations. He's a professor at UCT and a visiting fellow at the Oxford Martin School. He's led several UN institutions, most recently the Economic Commission for Africa, based in Addis Ababa, from which he stepped down just this past year. He has been recently appointed as a member of the African Union Reform Team, led by Rwanda's President Paul Kagame. And for those of you who have come to this conference for a few years, President Kagame, in fact, was our keynote speaker a few years ago. And so we're delighted today to welcome Carlos Lopez and his observations about what's going on in Africa.
Thank you. It's really a pleasure to be here, Peter, and all the organizers of this wonderful meeting, wonderful gathering. You know, when I entered the hall, I couldn't help but notice that it is named after Nelson Mandela. I was in Cape Town 11 February 1990, when Mandela first addressed South Africans after his liberation from prison. And I actually made the travel just to listen to him in that square in front of City Hall of Cape Town. And that is partly responsible for me being in Cape Town today, because it was that connection that was so strong emotionally that drove most of my work since. I was also in New York later that year, in June, when Mandela first visited New York, first visited the US after his liberation. And it was absolutely astounding to see the crowds all over the city, all the way from the airport, waiting to see Mandela pass. I couldn't just believe it. You know, it was live coverage on television, almost all channels. You couldn't see anything else. It was not the time of fake news. And everybody was just mesmerized by not so much what Mandela said, because he hadn't spoken, but by this incredible sense from everybody that this was a special occasion and this was a special person, this was a special something. And I can't help, you know, really relate that to the theme of the conference today, which is about narratives, about perceptions, and how Africa can produce the best, but also can be associated with the worst. So what is the reason for this incredible polarization of views that sometimes are attributable to the continent? And you know, and the proverb that serves as the framing for our conference today, until the lion learns to write, all stories will glorify the hunter, bothers me in two ways, although I love it as, you know, sort of a frame. First, it bothers me because the lion is really very lazy. And, you know, and the lion is a show-off, not gender sensitive, lets the female, you know, do the job, and then he just grabs the best pieces. And this is part of the African story. It's showing off power, authority, and yet, you know, not being necessarily working for it. The second thing that bothers me is that the lion is actually not very fast. You know, the fastest animal on earth happens to be African too, cheetah. Now, the difference between the cheetah and the lion is that normally the lion, he has no strategy. He just goes after everything. Goes after everything. You know, there's no real, you know, it's sort of in the sun and then see something pass and he goes after it. The cheetah is a calculator, is a strategist. Their success rate is about 80%. So they don't lose any energy just for the sake of trying. And you can see how slim they are. That tells you something. So narratives are important, and you know, perceptions are important. Think about Ebola, which is my favorite. When Ebola struck three countries, Sierra Leone, Guinea, and Liberia, immediately there were a lot of studies about the possible economic impact of Ebola. And one of the studies, happens to be from the World Bank, projected a loss for the continent of about $32 billion. Now, listen to this. The economies of these three countries, together, their combined GDP is $6 billion. It represents 3 weeks of Nigeria's economy. I'm sorry for them because it's not a very polite comparison. But how can a reality that if it actually erased the three countries from the map would cost $6 billion, transform itself into a $32 billion prospect of loss? The reason, it's not that our colleagues from the World Bank are completely crazy. It's because they felt that the impact of the image in the continent was going to be so great that it will have affected not just the three countries, but the entire continent. Well, they were wrong. And in fact, they end up with a revising of their estimates 1 year after Ebola for 3.2, which is nice. But what we learn from that lesson is that basically there is a self-fulfilling projection of negativity that ends up affecting Africa more than it should. And that is very much linked to what schools like this have to address, which is the issue of risk and how the risk perceptions have to be tackled insofar as Africa is concerned in a completely different way. I'll give you my most important insight, which is the fact that the combined GDP of the continent is underestimated by about 21%. How do I know this? Well, if you are familiar with statistics and methodological standards for national accounts, you know that the year base for national accounts should not be older than 5. If it is older than 5, normally you don't know some developments in the structure of the economy. You may underestimate the size. And in Africa, because of the demographic dimensions, it's obvious that it's going to be an underestimation, not an overestimation. And then you end up trying to project what you don't know with econometric models that may fail you. This is what happens in most African countries. I will give you the figure of the exact number of African countries that have their national accounts up to date. It's 12. There is one country, I will not name it because some of member of the audience may feel offended, that still uses as a reference year base 1965. That's the year of independence of that country. So you can imagine. No, it's not my country. You can imagine how artificial everything else you say about the economy of those countries is. And in fact, you know, if you count the number of additional points in GDP that the countries that have recently done what is called the rebasing exercise, you can easily come to this figure of 21% underestimation. Why is this important? This is important because Africa has the lowest fiscal pressure in the world. You know, normally, the fiscal pressure average in the world is about 35% of GDP. We are experiencing about 17%. With the figures that we know, imagine if it was the real figures of GDP. That will probably be around 12% fiscal pressure. There are no countries in the world, historically speaking, that have developed themselves, that have grown with such type of fiscal pressure. And you cannot compensate this by talking about FDI, by talking about aid, by talking about any possible capital inflows. If you have not fixed problem number one, don't start talking about your plan B, your plan C, your plan D. Fix problem number one. And problem number one is that we don't know enough about the economies of the continent. If we don't know enough, we have a very poor fiscal apparatus. And because we have a very poor fiscal apparatus, we tend to charge and tax the ones that are the most visible. And we don't make enough efforts to actually canvass what is required for sustainability in fiscal terms. And this is the insight that I want to really share with you. Because I think this is the answer for the resources that are required for many of the challenges that I'm sure this morning and this afternoon you'll be debating. Infrastructure, improving services, education, social protection, you name it. We are not going to be able to address those challenges if we don't fix first what is required in terms of fiscal reform that makes sense. And I say that makes sense because this is not a fiscal reform just to please macroeconomic equilibria, macroeconomic balance. It's not about, you know, whether our debt is sustainable. It's not about all these different elements that will be mentioned to you so many times. But in fact, all of them forget this base. Because you see, again, say that debt in Africa is a problem right now. Really? Well, when we finished structural adjustment, our debt to GDP ratio was 72%. Today is 36. It has increased 3 points in the last year. So that's the crisis. From 33 to 36, oh my God. I mean, after 20 years of structural adjustment, we were at 72. So why is it so much of a concern? It's a concern because debt cannot just be judged in terms of its ratio with GDP. It has to be on the basis of where can you pay it? Can you service it? And of course, if you don't fix problem number one, I just mentioned it, how are you going to service your debt? So everything comes to this problem number one. And it's a problem of governance, isn't it? It's a problem of economic governance. And if we fix that problem of economic governance, we are actually making sure that the ingredients that are required for the cheetah to run so fast are there. Because what we are witnessing is the race for Africa to industrialize. It's a latecomer's race. Let's not forget about it. As James just mentioned, it is a race that we are engaging in at the time where labor is changing so fast. I still believe that there is a lot of confusion about automation, robotization, and how technological developments are going to affect low-end value addition, and particularly countries that are so late in their industrialization process. You can't measure your productivity in technological terms the same way in Japan as you will measure in Burkina Faso. And people also confuse that. But be as it may, the chains have become global for a number of areas. And yes, in Africa, we can produce yogurt. We still import 68% of the yogurt we consume because we can't produce yogurt. But it's a completely different story if we're talking about aviation, we're talking about areas where robotization and automation are going to be predominant. So we have room, but this room is almost like a window. It will not last long. So we have to catch up fast. And if we are going to catch up fast, we need actually to have a good strategy. That's why it is important for us to realize that when we talk about industrialization, it should not be equated to manufacturing. Manufacturing is one dimension of industrialization. What we are talking is about modernizing the productive systems, making sure that they are up to the standards of the industrial era. That means productivity being completely different. That means agriculture being the subject of a lot of progress, because in every single historical reality, the agricultural productivity revolution has taken place because it was pulled by industrialization. And right now what we do in agriculture is basically drought resilience, food security, poverty reduction. Well, I love all those things. But the problem with them is that this is not a social sector. This is the economy. And if we are not going to really treat it as part of the economy, we are going to witness what we have been witnessing the last 20 years, which is an erosion of its contribution to GDP to such an extent that now we have 60% of the African population still dependent on the primary sector, and the contribution to GDP is less than 10%. Believe it or not, the number one contributor for Africa's GDP is services, which is not different from any other region in the world. And that has a lot to do with consuming, as someone was just mentioning in the previous panel, because 2/3 of our growth comes from consumption. But is this sustainable? Is this creating jobs? Is this transforming the economies? No. So we need really to try to have at the center of this strategy for industrialization the realization that we are not going to do it if we don't have three ingredients that for me are fundamental and have proven right in the various experiments of the recent past in Asia and also in Africa. You need to have ambition. And ambition comes with your capacity to project what Africa is going to be, not just what Africa is right now. And this you can size up country by country. You need to have sophistication because you need to understand global value chains. You need to understand that you cannot just repeat what others have done. Those niches are occupied. You need to realize that intellectual property, trade regimes, technological developments, access to capital, all of those things have become prohibitive for Africa and not favoring Africa. Therefore, we need to be smart. We need to be smart protectionists, for instance, because you cannot play like others did when they industrialized just crude protectionism, although Mr. Trump believes it can do so. And finally, you have to have, apart from ambition and sophistication, you have to have policy convergence, coherence. And what I mean by this is that, you know, you cannot have governments, private sector, and everybody talking about whatever subject they like. We are going to industrialize. And then everybody does a bit of what they think is good. And there is no convergence and no coherence. I normally say to the African leaders that you will understand industrialization when you understand it's not a business for the Ministry of Industry. And that's what most do. And that's what impedes progress. When you understand it's a government policy central for everything, then you will realize that all the different dots have to come together. Well, I'm afraid that having a strategy, making sure that you have determination and you have these ingredients in front of you as part of your cocktail is not the kind of thing that really the lion does. So let's be a cheetah. Thank you.
We have about 10 minutes for questions, and that three-part summary of what we need, ambition, sophistication, and coherence, convergence, I think is a great place to start in thinking about the macro ingredients to make for success. Who'd like to start with the first question? And what we'll do is we'll follow the process we've used before. Maybe we'll take three questions or so, and then we can start from there. So who'd like to get started? Yes, James.
Thank you, Dr. Lopez, for your comments. James Mwangi from Dalberg. I wondered, you made an interesting point about fiscal pressure, et cetera. And I wondered if you'd be able to link it to the question of informality, right? Because so much of our economy is informal, so few people pay tax, so few people vote like taxpayers, so people vote irresponsibly. Is that a fair surmise, that actually we may solve our governance problem and the balkanization of our politics by in some ways addressing informality and broadening our tax base?
Okay, so first question, the informality. Second question, in the back there.
Niyo Namuse, Side Business School. You touched on 3 points, ambition, sophistication, and policy convergence. And in my understanding, I think the ambition part you have, in excess, but the part that I think is critical to address is sophistication. There's a lot of work and focus on policy and policy coherence. We are not achieving it, yes. But the aspect of sophistication is one I want you to perhaps elaborate a bit more on, because I think that is the major challenge in Africa, where we have big dreams and we have all of this, but we do not have the know-how to get this done. Just a quick example is power. We don't have the, we are not training engineers, we are not training. So what is your view about how Africa can address the issue of sophistication?
Okay, one last question. The woman right there.
Thank you. My name is Michelle Chavunga. I'm doing some consultancy work with the World Bank, and I also own my own business. My question is around your point around policy coherence. Very much want to understand from your viewpoints whether you think African governments are doing enough to help build capacity and engaging enough within themselves, within different departments. And then my other second question quickly is, I mean, we talked earlier about the importance of access to finance and providing different financing options within Africa for different businesses, be it scale-ups or startups, as well as, mid-scale. Are we doing enough to provide those sources of finance? And if not, what are your thoughts around improving that? Thank you.
So 3 questions, actually 4, with a memory test for our, so informal economy, sophistication, coherence, and access to finance. All yours.
Thank you, Peter. Well, I know, James, you are familiar probably with the number of people in Kenya that pay taxes. It's about 2 million. Is this acceptable? It's unbelievable. And this is one of the most modernized economies in the continent. This is absolutely unacceptable. Now, the problem is that normally the excuse is to say, well, its informal sector is poor. Well, I'm actually very much concerned with the informality of the rich. I think this is the big problem. I normally tend to provoke business entrepreneurs and other associations when they invite me in Africa. And I say, let's talk about privatizing the private sector. And they look at me like, I'm talking Chinese. But in fact, this idea that we have that the state has to sponsor so many aspects that really do not belong to the realm of facilitation, to the realm of creating the right incentive structure, creating the right regulatory systems, and even providing good access to finance, and instead being just, like a stimulant for bad behavior. Most of the good experiments in Asia were based on a combination of very close relationships between private and public institutions. But what the public institutions would do typically when they will provide any form of subsidy would be to do it against targets. Without targets, no subsidies. So you want a subsidy on whatever X aspect of your process, you will get it, but against a target. And the target can be socially related, economically related. It can be part of, you know, creating the characteristics on the chain that will allow the country to position itself, etc. And I think this is what is missing in Africa. And therefore, we have this ongoing debate about informality that doesn't make too much sense for me. Because what you want in any country, Africa being no different in terms of each one of its countries, is to have progressive taxation. Now, if you introduce progressive taxation, there's no problem actually in having all the poor not paying taxes. I'm certainly for it. But that doesn't mean it should not enter the formal economy. So you have to find ways of getting them into the formal economy even without paying taxes, because that's the only way you are going to modernize your systems of production. And I think the debate has not really gelled yet, but I believe a certain number of countries are becoming more and more interested in approaching things differently and certainly obviating the need for tax increases. They are also realizing, you know, aid is going, it's diminishing, and the future is going to be through our own domestic resources. Just to give you a figure, aid to Africa has gone from $48 billion a year in 2000 to about $42 billion this year projection. And taxes collected in Africa have gone during the same period from $123 billion to about $600 billion today. But still, it's not enough. But you can see what the trends are. Now, on the issue of sophistication, I'll give you an example because I think it's better to illustrate with a specific example. And my example is from Ethiopia because I was living in Addis until November last year. So here is a country that decides that they are going to be a player on textiles and garments. This is going to be a hell of a challenge because this is a crowded area. The production is already quite well regulated, most of it coming from Asia and Southeast Asia in particular, with the labor costs factor that could have benefited Africa also being present in some countries in Asia, like Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, or Thailand. Why would anybody in their right mind come to invest in Ethiopia with all the problems that Ethiopia has, starting with infrastructure? Well, they decide to build an industrial park in one city called Awassa. For those who are interested, then you can Google and follow what I'm saying. And from scratch, they decide to build an industrial park that will be so powerful in terms of size, characteristics, that would export more textiles, just that park, than the country in Africa that exports the most textiles, which is Mauritius. Mauritius exports for about $950 million worth of textiles. Awas is supposed to reach, in 3 years, $1 billion. Is this going to work? Well, before they finished the park, all the space was already rented. All the big retailers are associated with the producers of this park, including here in the UK, Primark. But you have JCPenney, you have H&M, etc. So all the big ones. Why did they associate themselves with that park? And the answer is very simple. Complex to make happen, but very simple in terms of thoughts. What they did is that they went and visited every single country that is a big player in this market. So they went to Bangladesh, a team of about 7 Ethiopians, including a minister. They went to Sri Lanka, they went to China, they went to these different producing centers and realize that actually the owners of the production systems were not the retailers that actually buy the textiles, but rather locals that over time expanded their business, and they are, of course, subcontractors of the big retailers. The retailers keep some distance in terms of responsibilities, protect themselves, but they trust these subcontractors and therefore work with a specific number and don't want to change because they have the element of assurance, of quality, of timetables, and so on, that has to be there. And the Ethiopians convinced each one of these big producers coming from South countries to actually go and invest in Awasa. Because when they try to identify what was one reason that will make them come to Ethiopia, almost all insisted environmental and labor standards. And this is very interesting because you hear this discussion going in the newspapers here in countries like the UK or the US, and you don't realize that actually behind those environmental and labor standards are very specific metrics that have been put in place that are very difficult for the existing factories to meet because it will basically require a retrofitting that is very expensive. Whereas Ethiopia could leapfrog and could offer all of that without retrofitting and yet having the same attractiveness that actually got these people to go to those places in the first place, which was labor costs. Then you had to realize that you needed to have the skill set and infrastructure also aligned. So this park is next to a university that is now ranked in Ethiopia number one, Awasa University. And then, they put a rail system that connects with the main railroad that goes to Djibouti. So you have solved the biggest problems. Now they are about to solve the energy problem with the new dam. So that makes the place very attractive. And we are talking about the distance that people have to walk to the toilets, the number of hours of sunshine and natural light that gets into the plant, the recycling of the waters, how the fire extinguishers are located. So there's a huge number of very specific details that were put in place from the beginning in those plants, in that industrial park. So the magic is not to have a turnkey subcontractor that delivers you the park, which was the case, a Chinese company. The magic is to study the chain and making sure that you understand that you have competition out there and that you have to beat that competition and you have to find your niche in a very crowded market. That is sophistication. And I think that's what you see in Ethiopia. You see in a number of countries, but you don't see in most African countries. They will have an industrial park that is there, abandoned. Why? Because all of these aspects have not been thought through. All the paperwork in a country that is known for having an incredible bureaucracy, a bureaucracy that is 2,000 years old, has been simplified with a post that is a one-stop shop right at the industrial park. You only deal with that post, period. And they go through the maze of the various Ethiopian institutions. So you need to find the niche and you need to be sophisticated in so far as industrialization is concerned more than any other area. Now, the question about access to financing is related to what I just described. The moment you create the impression with the investor community that you are serious about your business, that you have the level of sophistication, it becomes much more easier to attract money. That's not the only way you can attract money. You can attract money by being corrupt. That's what DRC does. I mean, there are many ways of attracting money, but this is one way that is more sustainable and that brings that type of investment on a basis that's completely different, that will create a completely different rapport and relationship. You can see it also in a country like Rwanda. You know, I like very much the example of what happened with the automotive industry in Morocco that now is transforming itself also into an aviation hub because of the operation, maintenance, and repair capabilities that have been created by the automotive industry. And in a period of just about 10 years, you have already 5,000 people working on the aviation aeronautical industry in a country like Morocco. So I think we have to create this impression that attracting capital on itself is not the answer. It's what kind of capital and what kind of rapports are we establishing. A country like Thailand, I have an obsession with Thailand. I will tell you why. Because Thailand had 16 coups, 12 succeeded. And nobody talks about it. I mean, they keep pouring money there, a lot of production. They produce more industrial goods than any African country. 16 coup d'etats. But what is wrong with us? Our coups are not good. And you know, and the reason is this, you know, ecosystem someone was mentioning that creates the conditions for the attractiveness of the capital to go even above some of your governance challenges. And I think that's, for me, the key factor that explains some of the dynamics that we fail to understand. And I think your other question was about...
It was coherence.
Yes. Well, I will just say it in 1 minute. What I mean is that you need industrial policy. You know, every country that has done an industrial policy tries to basically have a comprehensive view of what are the different elements that integrate that policy. And it has to be comprehensive. It has to be capable of mobilizing the entire apparatus that has one single objective rather than having many objectives. I could elaborate on it, but you know, there's a lot of literature on it, and it will not be very difficult for you to find.
So thank you so much, Dr. Lopez.